So welcome back to income tax class. We are in fourth semester of BCom in subject of income tax. See, till now we have discussed about direct and indirect taxes, canons of taxation, features and history of income tax in India, definition and basic concepts of income tax. Under this heading, we have discussed about assessee, deemed assessee, assessee in default. In the previous class, we have learnt about assessment year, previous year, person. These three concepts we have learned in the previous class. Okay. Now we will discuss our next subtopic, that is agricultural income. But before that, I want to ask you one question. Okay. Now you tell me. So here I will write. Participants. B. Sirisha, are you there? B. Sirisha, hall ticket number 2652. Are you present? B. Sirisha. See, when
okay,
I...
Okay, sir.
Okay, right. One question for you from yesterday's class. Now, I will write one financial year. We have to tell its previous year and its assessment year. Okay? Now I am writing one year here. 2017, 2018. Okay. This year, is it visible to you, Sirisha? Are you able to see 2017, 2018? I wrote on the screen. Is it visible to you? Can you see? Please keep your microphone in unmute condition. I will ask you a question. B. Sirisha, unmute yourself. Please respond immediately. Don't waste time. Sirisha. Okay, next in the order, Pavitra. Unmute yourself, Pavitra. CH Pavitra 2673. Okay. Next, K. Srikanth. K. Srikanth, unmute yourself. 2747, K. Srikanth. Kirtana 2722. Kirtana, hall ticket number 2722. Unmute yourself and speak. Okay. Mirza Moin Beg, 2807. Mirza Moin Beg. Okay. Very good. Are you able to see the screen, Mirza Moin Beg?
Yes, sir.
Now you tell me, your question is, what is its previous year? 2017-18's previous year is what?
2016 March, 2017.
So its previous year is 2016-17. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay, very good. Now, Mittapalli Akhil, 2808.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Now you tell me, Moin Beg said that its previous year is 2016-17. This months you tell me, from which month it will start, at which month it will end?
April to March.
Very good. April 1st, 2016 to March 31st, 2017. Its previous year will be. Okay? Very good.
Yes, sir.
Very good. Now next. Another year I am writing. 2019-2020. Yes, Pavitra, are you there? Pavitra. Sirisha,
के श्रीकांत कीर्तना प्लीज अनम्यूट युवरसेल्फ एंड रेस्पॉन्ड कीर्तना सुमंत सुमंत आर यू देयर 2776 श्रावण कुमार नवीन
या सर इट्स मी सुमंत
यस सुमंत रेस्पॉन्डिंग वेरी गुड सुमंत नाउ युवर क्वेश्चन इज व्हाट इज द असेसमेंट ईयर फॉर द ईयर 2019-20 व्हाट इज द असेसमेंट ईयर What is the assessment year for the year 2019-20?
Sorry, sir, I don't know.
Okay, no problem, no problem. Shravan Kumar. Naveen. Mittapalli Akhil.
2021, sir.
Very good. Mittapalli Akhil, 2020-21. Very good. 1920's academic financial year is assessment year is going to be 2020-2021. Very good. Again, another chance I will give to Kirtana. Kirtana, are you present?
Sir.
Are you present?
Yes, sir.
Now. Very good. Now, Kirtana, tell me, this year will finance assessment year will start from which month? 2020's assessment year will start on which date?
April 1st.
Very good. 1st April 2022. It will end on which date?
March 31st, sir.
Very good. Very good. 31st March 2021. Okay, this we discussed in yesterday's class, no? In the previous class, we have discussed. Then why are you worried? Why are you afraid to speak? Why are you afraid to interact with me? Very simple questions I am asking. Pavitra, are you there? Pavitra. Okay, no problem. So did you understand now? 2017-18... Previous year is going to be 2016-17, whereas its assessment year is going to be 2018-19. Okay, similarly, 2018-19's previous year is going to be 17-18, and its assessment year is going to be 19-20, and 19-20's previous year is going to be 18-19, and its assessment year is going to be 20-21, like that. These topics we have discussed in yesterday's class, in the previous class. So I want to test how many of you are able to understand. Okay. Now come, these are all the topics that we have discussed, and I will start the new topic now. This deemed assessee in default, we have discussed, person we have discussed. Assessment year, previous year we have discussed, person we have discussed. Up to now, topics we have discussed. And what is agricultural income? We will discuss now. See, agricultural income, as you all know, our country depends mainly on agriculture. Our country is a rural economic background country, agricultural country. See, on agriculture, income tax is not there. Income tax is fully exempt. Please remember this. On agricultural income, there is no income tax. There are two reasons for that. There is no income tax on agriculture. One is, see, in our country, taxation system, under taxation system, some taxes are levied by central government. Some taxes are levied by state government. See, in our country, in our country's constitution, taxes, the responsibility, the right of levying a tax is divided into these categories. Central government will levy tax on certain issues. State government will levy tax on certain issues. See, this list is known as union list. On those items which are mentioned in union list, only central government will levy tax. On those items which are levied in state government list, that is state list, union list, state list. On those items which are mentioned in state list, state government will impose tax. And some items which are not included in union list and which are not included in state list, they are included in concurrent list. Concurrent list, CONCURRENT, concurrent list. I am repeating, in our country, the power of imposing a tax has been divided into three lists. One is union list, another one is state list, and the last one is concurrent list. See, on those items in which central government has power to impose the tax, that list is known as union list. On those items on which state government has power to levy tax, that list is known as state list. And the remaining items which do not fall in union list and which do not fall in state list will be covered in concurrent list. And remember, on the items that are mentioned in concurrent list, even state government can make law, can impose tax, or central government can also impose tax or can make law. In case both state government and central government mentioned a law, prepared a law, then whatever law that is mentioned by central government, that will be applicable on that list, on the items that are mentioned in list. Is it clear? Is it clear? Taxation structure in our country is like this: union list, state list, concurrent list. Is it clear? To power to impose laws, power to impose tax is divided into three categories. On items which are mentioned in union list, central government will make laws. On items which are mentioned in state list, law will be prepared, tax will be imposed by state government. On all the remaining items, both can prepare laws. But in case any clash between central government law and state government law, the law prepared by central government will be applicable. Is it clear? Am I clear? Please reply. Shall I repeat it or you are able to understand? Is it clear or shall I repeat? Nobody is giving answer. Is it clear or shall I say once again?
Clear, sir.
Clear, no? Okay. Now, coming to agricultural income. See, why there is no income tax on agricultural income means, see, the agriculture, the term agriculture is included in state list. Income tax is imposed by central government. That is why on agricultural income, there is no income tax. Please remember. And secondly, for agricultural incomes, the state government will collect land revenue. In land revenue, this tax will be levied. So that is why on agricultural income, there is no income tax. You have to remember that. On agricultural income, state will impose land revenue. State will collect land revenue. That is first point. Second point is the item of agricultural income that is included in state list. So that is why Income Tax Act is not applicable on agricultural income. In our country, agricultural income attracts zero tax. That you have to remember. Okay. Now coming to the question, what is agricultural income?
See, you see, agricultural income implies, see, first one, rent or revenue should come from agricultural land. Please remember it. According to section 10 of 1, section 10, subsection 1, rent or revenue should come from agricultural land, or income should come from agricultural land. And income from farm building, farm means agriculture. Agricultural building means farmhouses will be there, no, in agricultural fields. Income should come from farm buildings. In these three cases, it will be deemed as agricultural income, and there is no income tax on that agricultural income. Is it clear? Rent or revenue should come from agricultural activities. Income should be derived from agricultural activities. Income from farmhouse should come from a building which is located in agricultural field, agricultural land. In all these three cases, there is no income tax on agricultural income. Please remember that. Okay. Now, similarly, you have to remember certain conditions for agricultural incomes. What are those conditions? See, rent or revenue should be derived from agricultural land. Secondly, the land is used for agricultural purpose. Even though in agricultural field, if agriculture is not done, if agricultural activity is not done, that cannot be deemed as agricultural revenue or agricultural income. Rent or revenue should be derived from a land, and the land must have been used for agricultural purpose. Only then there will be no tax on agricultural income. And thirdly, the land should be situated in India. In a foreign country, if we have land and we cultivate agriculture, we are involved in agriculture, means we have to pay tax. These are the three conditions. Rent or revenue should have been derived from land. The land is used for agricultural purpose. The land should be situated in India. These are the three conditions for agricultural income. That if at all it has to be exempted from income tax, these three conditions should be fulfilled. Even if one condition is not fulfilled, it will not be deemed as agricultural income. It will be deemed as other income, and tax, income tax will be levied on that one, on that income. Did you understand? Is it clear? Yes, my dear students, is it clear? Or shall I repeat? I am repeating.
Clear, sir.
On agricultural income, there is no income tax in our country because the item falls in state list. So that is why states have a power to impose tax on agricultural income. By way of land revenue, they will collect tax. Okay? Apart from that, if a person has to get exemption on agricultural income, these three conditions have to be fulfilled. The land has to be situated in India. Rent or revenue should have been derived from that land. And thirdly, the land should have been used for agricultural purpose, not for other purpose. So these are the three conditions for agricultural incomes. Okay. And next one. So agricultural incomes, some examples I am explaining to you. See, salami or premium received by landlord at the time of transfer of agricultural holdings, nazars accepted by landlord for dealing with the question of succession, settlement, and partition of agricultural land, income from use of land for grazing of cattle, income from lease of land for grazing of cattle, profit on sale of a crop after harvest made by cultivating owner or tenant. So these are various examples are there. If you go through them, you can clearly understand. These are the examples of agricultural incomes. Okay. Nextly, these cannot be termed as agricultural incomes. These are non-agricultural incomes. And the person has to pay income tax on them. Okay. Let us take, for example, one or two I will discuss. Income from sale of wild grass. So in your agricultural field, you did not cultivate anything. You did not put any seeds. You did not grow any crop.
simply wild grass has grown in your agricultural field, you sold it for money, that is not agricultural income. Okay, income from sale of ginned cotton, this is also not agricultural income. Interest received by money lender in the form of agricultural produce, this is also not agricultural income. So these are examples of non-agricultural incomes. You go through them, you can clearly, you can easily understand. But the thing is, you should be able to understand that agricultural incomes are fully exempt from tax, whereas non-agricultural incomes are taxable. For agricultural incomes, we have to fulfill three conditions. One, the land should be situated in India. Secondly, agricultural activity should have been performed on that land. Thirdly, income or revenue should have been generated from that land. These are the three conditions to get exemption for agricultural income. Okay, so nextly, see, this is very, very important. Everybody should remember this. How in our country tax, income tax is levied. So income tax is levied under five heads. Please, you have to remember it throughout your life. Under five heads of, this is very, very important. Five heads of income are there. See, first of all, income tax will be levied on salaries, income from salaries. In a earlier classes, I mentioned, I have paid 10,000 rupees as income tax during the last year. That is income on my income from salary I paid. This is first head, income from salary. Next, second head is income from house property. Suppose if anybody of you are enjoying a house and you have given it for rent, you will receive rent from the tenant. Every month you will receive rent. On that rent, you have to pay tax because you are receiving income from tenant. So that is income from house property. Suppose you are involved in conducting business, organizing business, or you are involved in a professional work. You may become a lawyer, or you may become a chartered accountant afterwards. Then you will receive income. In such a case, in a such a condition, your income will be covered in this head, under this head, income from profits and gains of business or profession. Then income from capital gains. Capital gains means, see, you have, now you, the question I am asking for you, how many types of assets are there? How many types of assets are there? For your simple understanding, I am asking this question in order to explain capital gains. How many types of
assets?
Very good. Who told you? Sai Kumar, you are the person who gave answer. Is it Sai Kumar?
Yes, sir.
Very good. Very good. See.
Thank you, sir.
Assets can be classified as fixed assets. And secondly, what is the other type of classification? Next one, fixed asset and current asset. Fixed asset means, let us take for example, land or furniture or machinery. Let us take for example, these three are there. These are fixed asset. See, another example also I can give, gold ornaments are there. That is also fixed asset, gold. In your house or in your bank locker. These are fixed assets. Okay. Current assets means, what are the examples of current assets? Cash, bank balance. These two are enough for your understanding. Now you say,
Okay.
Fixed asset, land you used for a certain years and then after enjoying it for 12 years, you sold the land. For profit, you sold. When you purchased land, you have spent only 1,20,000. But when you sold it for 12 lakhs. Let us take for example. Okay?
that extra amount will be deemed as profit for you, and that profit you have to show under the heading of capital gains, income from capital gains. Did you understand? So if you are enjoying a salary, your income will be included in the head income from salaries. If you are enjoying rent from your tenant, that income you have to include in income from a house property. If you are involved in organizing business or you are involved in profession, that income will be included in income profits and gains of profession or business. If you enjoyed fixed asset for a certain period of time and afterwards you sold, that income needs to be included in capital gains. Did you understand? Is it clear? Is it clear?
Yes,
see, this is the last head. See, whatever incomes that you earn, which cannot fall, which do not fall under either salaries or income from house property or business or profession or capital gains, those incomes will fall under income from other sources. Let us take for example, Sai Kumar went to Kaun Banega Karodpati and has won 1 crore rupees. Is it a salary income for him? No, it is not his salary. Is it rent income for him? No. Is it his business income? No. Is it his capital gains? No. So that income you have to include in income from other sources. Or one of your friends has won a lucky lottery. Okay. Lottery, he has purchased and he has won 10 lakh rupees in the lottery. You have to include that amount under this head, income from other sources. Okay. These are the 5 heads of income. So an individual's income, a person's income can be included only under these 5 heads, not more than that. Okay. So tomorrow I will ask everybody these 5 heads of income. This should be what you call by you. Everybody should tell me. See, if you are unable to answer tomorrow, I will make you to get out of my class. Is it clear, Sai Kumar, Sirisha, Pavitra, Kirtana, Mirza Mohini, Mittapalli Akhil, Nandini, Naveen, Singhabhoina, Sravan Kumar, Singhanabhoina. Tomorrow I will ask you, all whoever attends the class tomorrow, you have to answer this question. What are the 5 heads of income? It should be even
okay,
if I
sir.
Ask you in your dream, you should be able to answer me. That's all. Like that, you read this. In India, income tax will be calculated based on the heads of income's income. The total under all these heads will be added, and based on that, your income tax will be calculated. After processing means your savings, your investment, all those things will be taken into consideration. And at the end, on the combination of all these incomes, income tax will be levied on you and will be collected from you. So that is why this is very, very important. And everybody should and must tell me the answer to me tomorrow. If I ask you and if you fail to unmute, means I will remove you from my class. Is it clear? I hope it is clear.
Clear, sir.
I am coming back to the syllabus once again, why it is important. I will tell you, I will show you. See, I have discussed just now. Income from salaries, this is the first head. Income from house property, this is the second head. Is it clear?
Clear, sir.
Income from profits and gains of business or profession, this is the 4th unit for us. And in 5th unit, capital gains and income from other sources. 2 heads are included in 5th unit. So that is why in all our subsequent classes, these 5 heads we have to tackle. So that is why everybody should remember them. So I hope you understood the significance of